In Chapter 5, The Constituent Elements of Language, we're going to look at how thought and language are intertwined in Mueller's own worldview, and how roots are meant to shed light into this subtlety. Mueller does us a great service in breaking down his chapters into many subsections according to their various topics, and perhaps most notable here in this list is page 207, where he discusses the key difference between the science of language and thought by reference to roots. So in reading this chapter, we have four key goals. Well, the first will be to be introduced to grammar and grammatical categories. Then we'll proceed to grammatical categories and their relation to psychology. Then we'll provide an introduction to verb roots. And then we'll delve into Vedic poetics and see how grammar guides the interpretation of semantics. Mueller was trying to prove that the whole of what we call the human mind is realized in language and in language only. And if we recall, he wrote, "Nothing could be more accurate and a more telling simile of the progress of thought in language than the progress of excavation and arching in a tunnel through a sandbank. It is extremely difficult to express the simultaneity of these two acts. And in the science of language, the quest is to uncover the roots of language." Furthermore, we found that the overall structure guiding Mueller's categorization schema is between nouns and verbs, that is, between mind as noun and to think as verb. Ultimately, I want to stress that what is important here is not so much the particular categories that Mueller establishes for himself, but rather the form of the overarching structure that he uses for these particular concepts like sensation and percepts and conception and names. This metacategorical form, so to speak, typically governs thought in ways I hope you come to appreciate by the end of this chapter, if not only to better understand your own thoughts, then at least to understand the thoughts of those in the wilderness. Now, for example, what this means is that you could create a verb called information and define a noun called informants and keep the root to inform. Or you can create another node called interpretation and say the verb is interpretation, the interpretants are the noun, and the root is to interpret. Now again, it doesn't matter how many different subsystems of the mind that we mention. The point is that there is a distinction being drawn between the verb to think and the noun mind. So as we proceed through this chapter, I'm reminded of a quote from the Panchatantra. "Book learning is endless, life is short, and the difficulties are many. We should keep to what is essential, like swans extracting milk from water." Our next task would have been to discover the constituent elements of language and to watch the true historical development of the human mind. For philological purposes, it matters little, as I said in 1866, what opinion we hold on the origin of roots, so long as we agree that with the exception of a number of purely mimetic expressions, all words, such as we find them, whether in English or in Sanskrit, encumbered with prefixes and suffixes, and moldering away under the action of phonetic decay, must in the last instance be traced back, by means of definite phonetic laws, to those definite primary forms which we are accustomed to call roots. These roots stand like barriers between the chaos and the cosmos of human speech. Whoever admits the historical character of roots, whatever opinion he may hold on their origin, is not a Democritean, does not hold that theory which I call the Bow Wow theory, and cannot be quoted in support of Darwin's opinion that the cries of animals represent the earliest stage in the language of man. Now, Mueller's argument is very simple. Roots are not created from sounds. And the reason that is because for him, he intuits that the verbs come prior to the nouns. And this is entirely in line with the intuition that the realm of roots is different in some fundamental sense than that of names, which are but results of naming through language. Having shown, as I hope, in chapters 2 and 4, that the theory of evolution, as held by Darwin himself, does by no means necessitate the historical descent of the animal man from some other kind of animal, we now find ourselves free to undertake the analysis of language without any limitation as to the elements we ought to look for, and we therefore proceed to our task without any let or hindrance. If we should find that the ultimate elements in our analysis of language turn out to be the cries of animals, more or less successfully imitated by men, or something like the sounds which men utter themselves when suffering from pain or joy, or any other powerful emotion, this would prove a strong support of the opinion of certain followers of Darwin, stronger than any, I should venture to say, which have been produced by themselves. If, on the contrary, our analysis should lead us to a different result, we know at all events that our rear is safe, and we no longer fear that the supposed descent of man from some other animal can again be appealed to as proving, without any further arguments, the utter futility of our researches. We find here in this passage Müller defending his science of thought against charges made by evolutionary theorists of his time who had argued that, like everything else in science, human language was merely an extension of what we find in the animal kingdom, such as animal cries or emotional utterances. Recall that Müller believed what separated men from animals was language, and therefore he believes that evolutionary theory is unable to provide a rigorous account of the origins of language from observing mere regularities in the animal kingdom. Instead, as we recall from the previous slide, he believes that the foundations of language begin with roots. And we will return to this evolutionary critique later, but for now, it is important to pay attention to the opposition Müller constructs. That is, between language being nothing other than animal cries and emotional utterances, and language being something other than what is found in the animal kingdom. Now, a brief note here. Müller is not against evolutionary theory. In fact, he accepts it wholeheartedly. However, he believes that the interpretation of evolution provided by the theorists of his time is limited in its causal explanation. It is worth thinking about why we should believe that language is nothing other than animal cries and emotional utterances. Is that all mathematics is? Couldn't it be said of evolutionary theory itself? What cry or emotional whim does evolutionary theory represent in the repertoire of human language? I think his broader critique against evolutionists is better captured by Donald Simmons in his book, The Evolution of Human Sexuality, where he writes, "In summary, the rhetoric of Richard Dawkins' The Selfish Gene exactly reverses the real situation. Through the use of metaphor, genes are endowed with properties only sentient beings can possess, such as selfishness, while sentient beings are stripped of these properties and called machines." This is all to say, verb language, parading around as nouns, obscures the search for causal foundations, which for Müller are the roots. Why should a word like information, or an idea like a pattern or symmetry or a repetition, be any more foundational a unit of reality like reformation or deformation? Merely naming something as natural or God doesn't mean there is a comprehensive totality of thought behind that utterance, nor even suggestive of understanding by the person making or doing the name calling. Words like adapt, survive, and reproduce are merely pointing to a psychological mechanism, which itself implies some form of action or act, or a set of acts. Müller believes, in line with much of the humanities, that the search for roots is just a different kind of task, which requires a different type of science, a method, and an accompanying discussion more fundamental than those dealing with merely categorizing names, as is often done when making phylogenetic trees. When we analyze any language and separate all that is merely formal in words, we always arrive in the end at certain residua which resist further analysis. It matters little how we call these stubborn residua, whether roots or elements or phonetic types. So let's take this slowly. Let's begin with words, what we usually think of as something with meaning. All words can be partitioned into two broad categories, those of content and those of function. So the first are called content words. Now, content words typically possess primary semantic content and contribute to the meaning of a sentence in which they occur. And function words primarily denote grammatical relationships between content words. A more traditional partitioning of words is often under the umbrella of parts of speech. So I'm going to go through them one by one to give you a sense of how content and function as two categories are being distinguished from each other. Adverbs and adjectives are found under the category of content words. That is, they are supposed to possess a primary meaning. Now, an adverb modifies a verb, an adjective or another adverb. So for example, she sang loudly. The word loudly modifies the verb sing. You are quite right, where quite modifies the adjective right. She sang very loudly, where the word very modifies the adverb loudly. And then we have adjectives, which modify a noun or a pronoun. So for example, I have another shoe just like this one somewhere in my room. Another modifies the noun shoe, and this modifies the pronoun one. Now it might be worth pointing out here that because adverbs and adjectives are modifying something else, which seems to be more primal, that is, verbs and nouns, it might be better to classify adverbs and adjectives as function words as opposed to content words. However, as we will discover later, this distinction is likely inconsequential, since the governing principle behind these differences is far more intuitive. And then we arrive at traditional function words, like prepositions, pronouns, conjunctions, and interjections. Prepositions typically express spatial, that is location or direction, temporal, that is time, or relations expressing comparison, content, instrument, means, manner, cause, purpose, reference, amongst others. So for example, words like to, of, with, in, from, for, under, throughout, atop, towards, before, after, about, until, etc., are prepositions. Pronouns are used to substitute for a noun or a noun phrase. So for example, I, me, my, we, us, our, you, your, that, former, latter, whom, what, which, one, something, nobody. And conjunctions connect words, phrases, or clauses. For example, and, but, or, so, yet. And interjections are expressions that occur as an utterance on their own and express a spontaneous feeling or reaction. Whew! Uh-oh. Yikes. We can expand our list of function words to include determiners, intensifiers, interrogatives, and numerals. Determiners serve to express the reference of a noun or noun phrase in context. So for example, the definite or indefinite articles, the, a, or an, demonstratives, such as this or that, possessive determiners, like my or their, cardinal numerals, 1, 2, 3, quantifiers, many, both, all, and distributive determiners, like each and any. Intensifiers enhance or give additional emotional context to the word it modifies. So for example, very, so, quite, rather. Interrogatives introduce questions, who, what, when, where, why, how. And numerals describe a numerical quantity. That could be a cardinal number, an ordinal number, first, second, third, how frequent something is, once, twice, or how partial, as in fractions, partial or whole. So these function words are, in a sense, acting outside the primary content words. And perhaps the intuition can be captured by this image here. This image represents an agent who is the deictic center, and other agents whom he is pointing to, including a spatial and temporal axis. In a sense, we could argue that function words are meta. These are words about other words. And as we will soon find out, using functional words to denote something meta or outside is going to play a key role in theory and poetics. So for example, the word about is a functional word, and the word meta functions as the functional word. And then there are the content words. Now the content words are the most renowned and most universal. As far as we know, every language makes a grammatical distinction that looks like a noun-verb distinction. So our content words are either nouns or verbs. A noun is a word that refers to a thing, a person, an animal, a place, a quality, an idea, or an action itself. And a verb is a word that conveys an action, an occurrence, or a state of being. So speaking of poetics, I want to present a preliminary observation. We see here a distinction between content words and function words, and amongst the content words, we see a distinction between nouns and verbs. So I'd like to propose the distinction between stable and dynamic. Stable in the sense of a closed system, something exact, something precise, something stationary, or something fixed, and dynamic, a sense of an open system, energetic, capable of motion, change, and or development. And how this dualism between stable and dynamic maps beautifully to the notion of content and function, where content possesses something primary, possessing something precise or stationary, and function words looking at relationships between things, capturing a motion, a change, something developing. And just like Mueller, who distinguished between mind, the noun, and to think, the verb, we also will find a distinction between semantics and pragmatics, where semantics looks at words and their meanings, and pragmatics relating those words with the context or the outside influence upon these linguistic utterances. Again, functional in nature. Now I should note here, we are not suggesting that content words, stable, and semantics are the same thing, nor that function words, dynamic, and pragmatics relate the same way. But there is a peculiar intuition where something is being kept stable and the other is gesturing towards something outside this stability. And this intuition is going to help us organize how thinkers organize their ideas. For once you see it, it'll become very clear where they're getting their distinctions from. And furthermore, what type of words they are using to make note of these subtle intuitions in language. Now, returning back to Mueller, we can take this dualistic intuition and apply it to his own categories. Recall his desire of reintroducing the word logos into philosophic discourse. We can now couple this with the notion of roots that he's introduced. This pair, logos and roots, will serve as our anchors throughout the rest of this book. Since roots stand like barriers between the chaos and the cosmos of human speech, they will fulfill the function of words like meta in the science of thought. Now again, this does not mean that logos, content, and nouns refer to the same thing, and that verbs, function, and roots relate in the same way. But there's an underlying intuition here that we're going to explore in depth. What is important is the fact that after we have removed the whole crust of historical growth, when we have broken up every compound and separated every suffix, prefix, or infix, there remain certain simple substances which will yield to no solvent. It was this simple process of etymological analysis and synthesis which I try to represent in as clear a light as possible in my lectures on the science of language, first published in 1861. So Mueller here invokes the study of etymology. Now etymology is the study of how words are formed and tracing how these words have changed over time. We're going to take upon an example to see what exactly it means to get words from roots. So the word I've chosen is international. The word international consists of three units: the word nation, the suffix al, and the prefix inter. Nation is a noun and refers to a stable community of people. The suffix al adds the sense of or pertaining to, thus turning the word nation into the adjective national, which thus means relating to a nation, common to or characteristic of a nation. And the prefix inter adds the sense of between, amid, or among. And when you combine inter with national, we get the adjective international, meaning occurring or carried on between nations. Thus, strictly speaking, in etymology, we've explained how the word international is formed. But here we can go even further and trace how the words have changed over time. The word nation comes from the Middle English nation, which itself derives from the Old French nation, which itself comes from the Latin natio. And from here, we can trace it back to a Proto-Italic, which itself goes further back to a Proto-Indo-European word genitus, which is itself composed of the word gene and a suffix tis. The word gene means to produce, to beget, or to birth, and a suffix which derives abstract or action nouns from verb roots. Now, this root gives rise to many familiar English words that we have, such as native, generate, gene, germ, genesis, king, renaissance, and gentile. And what is important for us here is that the root gene is capturing the verb to produce, to beget, or to birth. Now, no English speaker today will say that native, gentile, germ, and king refer to the same thing. But there is a sense in which they all relate in a similar way. And that relationship is being captured by the sense of the verb root. And similarly, we can look at the suffix -ul, which derives from a Middle English suffix, which comes from the Latin suffix -alis, which goes back to the Proto-Indo-European -le, perhaps from -el, meaning to grow or to nourish, and the prefix -inter, coming from the Latin -inter, going back to the Proto-Indo-European -henter, meaning between, back to the root -hen. Now, all of this is to merely demonstrate how a word like international has lurking behind it meanings that are not immediately apparent, yet contributing to the overall sense of the word, and how this etymological relationship both constricts the possible meanings of this word and afford it the ability to relate to other words which invoke similar verbal imagery. Such as we saw, the word to birth means to bear, which means to carry. And therefore, a birther is one who carries, or one who bears a child. And a child comes from the root gelt, which means a womb or a fetus. And that root itself comes from the root gel, which means to ball up or to amass, as in to coagulate and to come together. And we see here how the verb roots are preserving the imagery that is supposed to be associated with that particular word. And in later lectures, we'll explore what the relationship between this imagery and meaning is. For once we understand that relationship, sacred poetics are going to be a breeze, pun intended. We can now use our previous intuition between content words and function words and suggest that the word international contains two content words and two functional words, and that the meaning of international captures a sense of something between those that pertain to a producer or a birther. But here we return to the founder of the word international, Jeremy Bentham, who wrote, "The word international, it must be acknowledged, is a new one, though it is hoped sufficiently analogous and intelligible. It is calculated to express, in a more significant way, the branch of law which goes under the same name of the law of nations, ius gentium, an appellation so uncharacteristic that, were it not for the force of custom, it would seem rather to refer to internal jurisprudence." Now, the reason why Bentham introduced the word international was primarily to distinguish between the affairs happening within the nation and between nations, hence international. And do make note here that the root for the word international, or nation, is preserving the Latin gentium. Those who have read these lectures will remember how strongly I opposed any attempt on the part of the students of language to go beyond roots, such as we actually find them at the end of a most careful analysis. But I believe it is now generally admitted, even by some of my former opponents, that the slightest concession to what, not ironically, but simply descriptively, I call the bow-wow and poo-poo theories in the etymological analysis of words would have utter ruin to the character of the science of language. It is pleasant to find, as one grows older, how certain dangerous tendencies, which one had to oppose with all one's might, simply vanish and are seen no more. We will return later to the treatment of the bow-wow and poo-poo theories in etymological analysis that Mueller here is critiquing. Very simply, the bow-wow theory argues that language emerged through onomatopoeia, or the imitation of the sounds in the natural world. That is to say, man merely imitates what he hears, and that is the origin of language. The poo-poo theory, on the other hand, argues that language originated from emotional exclamations of pain, joy, and surprise. Mueller here is merely suggesting that we focus on what's available in front of us, that is, the verb roots, and not theorize beyond the data. So we proceed to an analogy between the roots of language and the cells of biology. So far, there is a certain similarity between the discoveries of physiologists and philologists. The important result which has been obtained by a truly scientific study of language is this, that after accounting for all that is purely formal as the result of juxtaposition, agglutination, and inflection, there remains in the end certain simple elements of human speech, phonetic cells, commonly called roots. In place, therefore, of the old question of the origin of language, we have now to deal with a new question of the origin of roots. Very briefly, juxtaposition refers to using words without the explicit presence of linking elements that express the connection between them. Agglutination, meaning to glue together, refers to how words are formed by stringing together sounds where each sound remains meaningful by itself. An inflection adds grammatical information to the word while retaining its core meaning and its grammatical category. With these in mind, Mueller says, these simple substances being granted, we can understand the whole structure of language. We can make again the language which we have unmade. And therefore, the science of language functions like chemistry, where one can break down a sentence into its constituent roots and reconstruct any sentence given a set of roots. Here, however, the analogy between the two sciences in their solution of the highest problems comes to an end. There are indeed two schools of physiologists, the phylogenetic and the monogenetic, the former admitting from the beginning a variety of primitive cells, the latter postulating but one cell as the source of all being. Polygenetic refers to the theory that life emerged from many different cells. And as Mueller writes, Darwin, as we saw, was satisfied with admitting 4 or 5 beginnings for plants and the same number for animals. The monogenetic theory, on the other hand, argues that life emerged from a single cell. Quote, the ancestor of plants and animals and men, a self-generating power, end quote. In short, we can call this the one and the many problem. That is there a single cause, or are there multiple causes? These roots are what remains in the crucible after the most careful analysis of human language, and there is nothing to lead us on to search for one primordial root, or for a small number of uniform roots, except the medieval idea that nature loves simplicity. There was a time when scholars imagined they could derive a language from 9 roots, or even 1, but these attempts were purely ephemeral. Some of these roots are, no doubt, secondary and tertiary formations, and may be reduced to a smaller number of primary forms. But here, too, philological research seems to me to show far more deference to the commandments of true philosophy than the prevalent physiological speculations. While the leading physiologists are striving to reduce all variety to uniformity, the student of language in his treatment of roots often distinguishes where, to all outward appearance, there is no perceptible difference whatsoever. If in the same language, or in the same cluster of languages, there are roots of exactly the same sound, but different in their later development, a separate existence and an independent origin are allowed to each. Mueller here reiterating the point that the goal of the science of language is not to bias the data in pursuit of simplicity. The same sound is permitted to have very different meanings if their historical development permits it. And this is significant because Mueller is putting emphasis on meaning and not merely on sound. Next, he looks at how roots identical in form differ in their meaning. He writes, "It would require many pages to exhaust the list of words derived from this one root, da, to give. But what I wish to point out is this, that by the side of this root, da, there is another root, da, exactly the same in all outward appearance, consisting of da and a, and yet totally distinct from the former." I have gone and taken the various examples Mueller provides in the pages under the subsection and represented them here in this table for clarity. We can see that the root da has four distinct meanings in Sanskrit, and we find these meanings appear in use in both Sanskrit and other Indo-European languages, such as Greek, Latin, and French. Da can mean to give, as in dadami, which finds expression in the noun datram, a gift, or a donation. And we find this meaning preserved in numerous examples, such as in the English, surrender and dowry. Da can mean to cut, as in diti, which finds expression in the noun datram, a sickle or a knife. It could also mean to bind, as in diati, and it also gives rise to the verb to know, as in the Greek, adeis. Note here how the word gift and give sound similar. That's because they share the same root. We are provided with another example where the same sound takes upon multiple meanings. In this case, the root is gr. Gr can take on three meanings. The first is to swallow, as in girati. The other is to call, as in girate. And the last is to wake, as in ajigaha. What's interesting with this root is that many believe that it is onomatopoeic. That is, the root comes from a gargling sound, which finds expression in the English word gargle. Mueller writes, it is conceivable that these two roots, to swallow and to call, may have been originally the same, and that gr from meaning to swallow may have come to mean the indistinct and disagreeable noise, which even now is called swallowing the letters, or what we now say, swallowing one's words. He continues, many instances might be given, more than sufficient to establish the principle that even in the same language, two or more roots may be discovered, identical in all outward appearance, yet totally different from each other in meaning and origin. Then why, it may be asked, do students of language distinguish where students of nature do not? Why are physiologists so anxious to establish the existence of cells, uniform from their beginning, yet, I quote from Professor Haeckel, capable of producing by the processes of monogamy, gemmation, polysporogamy, and amphigony, the endless variety of living creatures? Now the question being asked here is, how can something which is uniform result in something radically different? Physiologists don't want to name two dissimilar things with the same name. There must be an identifiable cause for the difference. And since we are speaking of roots, ideally, we would want to attribute a different name based on a different root to a given cause that characterizes the nature of that thing. Students of language, too, might say, like the physiologists, that in such cases as the root da, the difference of mixture in the endless varieties of consonants and vowels are so fine as to be, for the present at least, beyond the power of human perception. If they do not follow that siren voice, it is because they hold a fundamental principle of reasoning, which many evolutionist philosophers neglect, that if two things, be they roots or cells or anything else, which appear to be alike, become different by evolution, their difference need not always be due to outward circumstances, commonly called environment, but may be due to latent dispositions which, in their undeveloped form, are beyond the powers of human perception. If two roots of exactly the same sound produce two distinct families of words, we conclude that though outwardly alike, they are different roots. Here Mueller is offering two explanations as to why difference should be maintained. The first is that when consonants and vowels are combined, they form a mixture of sound which makes the relevant unit which causes their difference imperceptible to us. This is akin to something like the uncertainty principle, where detecting the cause is beyond perception. And the second reason is that there may be non-environmental latent dispositions that are not immediately perceptible to us that require development or change over time in order to manifest. And this is akin to a hidden variables hypothesis, where to look for a singing or reading gene may be futile, since these are emergent actions which are not immediately perceptive when looking at an embryo or an earlier developmental stage. We do not expect to discover the origin of living roots by dissolving them into their inorganic or purely phonetic elements, for although every root may be reduced to at least one consonant and one vowel, these consonants and vowels are simply the materials, but not the elements of language. They have in fact no real independent existence. They are nothing but the invention of grammarians, and their combination would only give rise to meaningless sounds, never to significant roots. While the physiologist can still entertain a lingering hope that with the progress of chemical science, it may be possible to produce a living cell out of given materials, we know that roots are simple, that they cannot and should not be decomposed, and that consonants and vowels are lifeless and meaningless materials, out of which no real root ever arose, and out of which, certainly, nothing like a root can ever be constructed. The root da, for instance, means, as we saw, to give. Dissolve it into the and a, and you have a meaningless slang and scum. Recompose the and a, and you have indeed the same sound, but its life and meaning are gone, and no language could, by its own free choice, accept such an artificial compound into its grammar or dictionary. Mueller here is arguing that meaning is something outside the names and their interrelationships. That is, combining sounds or material parts into speech, material wholes, does not indicate that meaning has been produced. And this remains one of the most fundamental problems in all of linguistic science. What is the relationship between meaning and sound? And we are going to find time and again this same fundamental problem reincarnate in many different forms. Such are some of the coincidences and some of the differences between biology and philology in their attempts to solve the problem of the origin of life and the origin of language. And the question does now arise, are we, in the science of language, driven to admit that roots, because they yield to no further analysis, are therefore to be accepted as unintelligible in their origin, as miraculously implanted in man, but not in other animals? Or may we hope to be able to go beyond this limit and discover something which, while it may make the origins of roots perfectly intelligible in man, explains to us at the same time why they could never have arisen in any other animal? And this is the central thesis of Mr. Mueller's book, The Science of Thought. Let us see first of all what roots are not. Roots are not either interjections or imitations of natural sounds. Interjections such as hu and imitations such as bow wow are the very opposite of roots. And why? Because roots are definite in sound, but general in meaning, while interjections and imitations are general, that is vague, and varying in sound, but definite and singular in meaning. I'd like to introduce a subtle distinction in semantics between denote and connote. Words can denote things and words can connote things. Denote means to refer or to specify a primary meaning. It indicates the narrow scope of the meaning of a word. So for example, the word home denotes a building and means exactly a structure. Whereas connote is used to suggest or imply an additional meaning, and it indicates a broader scope of meaning of the word. So for example, the word home, because it now denotes a structure, it connotes warmth and implies stability. And in keeping with our goal to build our intuition, the words denote and connote map nicely onto the content word and function word dichotomy we established earlier. Nothing seems so easy, yet nothing is in reality so difficult as to represent either the sounds by which our own feelings manifest themselves, or natural sounds such as the notes of birds, the howling of the wind, the falling of a stone, by articulate imitations. The Frenchman, as an observant traveler has remarked, expresses surprise by ah, the Englishman by oh, the German by e. The Frenchman says, ah, c'est magnifique. The Englishman, oh, that is capital. The German, eh, das ist ja prächtig. Nor do these interjections express exactly the same feeling. They all express surprise, no doubt, but the surprise peculiar to each of these three national characters. The surprise of the Englishman is restrained and deep. In saying, oh, he swallows half of his admiration. The surprise of the German is high and sharp. In saying, e, he almost chirps with delight. Müller's key point here is that there remains something outside the actual articulation that is governing how the articulation manifests. Although all of these interjections, which are functional words, are used to denote surprise, this surprise is expressed in multiple different words. So if sounds were merely reflective of particular emotions, and that sounds and emotions were both universal, then we shouldn't see a difference in how they manifest. But I'd like to return back to this notion of signifying something outside of language. And there are two principal methods we see used to signify this externality. The first is contradiction, and that's something we'll return to later. And the other is the self-referential, that is turning something towards itself. So to demonstrate this, let's look at the word surprise. At a surprise party, everyone says surprise as an interjection to elicit the surprise. The word surprise literally means to overtake. And in the case of the surprise party, the word surprise is the surprise. That is to say, the word surprise, being an interjection, is eliciting the surprise itself. And in that sense, surprise is the surprise. But as we all know, merely saying surprise doesn't result in a surprise. And this is where delving into the etymology of the verb roots helps us be more precise with what we mean when we say surprise. And comes from the Latin super and prendere, meaning to take or to catch or to hold. And prendere itself can be broken down into the prefix pre, meaning pre or for, and hendo, meaning to take or to seize. The word prehendo shares in its roots with the word praida, which means to plunder and to pillage, or the spoils of war, prey, a game in the hunt, gain and profit. And as we saw earlier, how the root da, to give, gives rise to the noun datrum, a gift or a donation. We see here another instance in which a root, meaning to take or to seize, gives rise to a noun meaning plunder or the spoils of war. If we go back further into the Proto-Indo-European, we find that the word super derives from uper, meaning over and above, where we get the word uber, and the root breh, meaning before, in front of, and ged, meaning find, hold, and seize and take. Now the root ged is where we get the modern word get, and preget would give us words like prey, predator, and prison, and comprehend and apprehend. So to say that surprise means to overtake, some might claim that a surprise is called such because it overtakes our attention. Others, that it overtakes our sensations and conceptions. Still others argue that they overtake perceptions, expectations, and predictions. But whatever a surprise might be, it overtakes, leaving us guessing at how it gets us above our everyday prisons, our habits of comprehension. And we can go further with the imagery that we've just invoked with the verb root. If fights, flights, and frights are not surprising in war, then we could perhaps say that surprises feel like a stimulus that stings like a stick. The words stick, sting, and stimulus come from the same root. but they preserved the imagery of hunting in the wilderness and of feelings of sharpness and pointedness which disrupt the peace. Now be warned, this is how sacred poetics are to be comprehended. If you're not paying attention to the verb roots, you'll sound crazy. The words used to communicate won't mean what their authors intend them to mean. And we see here an instance in which very, very subjective elements, like feelings of sharpness and imagery of scarcity and war, are being encoded in the words that are being used. But more on this later. So a surprise is a surprise. And this is an example of an autological or self-referential word, since its meaning refers to itself. Other such examples include, this is a sentence, word is a word, noun is a noun. And recall how the functional word as in words as words played the role of the word meta, which itself is a functional word. That is, the word represents a self-referential relationship, thus giving it a characteristic of being a functional word. This becomes important when thinking about how to use language to denote something outside language. And in this case, Mueller is trying to capture the peculiar national characters of a group of people. He uses a functional word. And that's no coincidence, since a functional word is supposed to operate on a content word from outside. And the word outside is itself a functional word. But we'll take this very slow. I know that this can get extremely confusing immediately, because we haven't yet mastered the imagery underlying a lot of these words. So if you were to try to organize language according to the content word, function word dichotomy, you'd get lost immediately. Some ancient philosophers, beginning with Plato in his Cratylus, and some very recent scholars too, have brought themselves to imagine that there is some hidden connection between certain letters, consonants, and vowels, and certain meanings. Who can doubt, they say, that in German, for instance, such words as all beginning with W express the idea of a slow movement, while words beginning with a st convey the idea of rest or resistance. This subject, though full of pitfalls, is most interesting, and if cleverly handled, not without a certain plausibility. Nay, if we enter more deeply into it, not without a certain truth. Only we must not allow ourselves to imagine that consonants and vowels by themselves can ever convey any meaning, for the simple reason that neither vowels nor consonants had ever any independent existence in language. For scientific purposes, all observations of the supposed inherent meaning of letters have hitherto proved not only useless, but very mischievous. If only extended over a sufficiently wide field of language, they generally neutralize themselves. Who does not imagine, for instance, that there is, as Humboldt says, some hidden connection between the letter N and the concept of negation? Yet as a matter of fact, there are languages, for instance, Cyrenian, in which no means yes. Speaking of negation, the Hebrew word is lo, and the Arabic word is la. And Mueller makes sense here. If a concept so foundational such as negation does not have the same sound form in its articulation, then what could we possibly ever make of those words that do share a sound? And this speculation is by no means old, as a recent article in 2016 published, Sound Meaning Association Biases Evidenced Across Thousands of Languages, looks at 100 words in over 4,000 languages to find similarities, and indeed they do find them. But the findings are scarce. And in this article, some of the evidence that they provide is as follows. Words for tongue typically have an L. Words for nose typically have an N. Words that indicate something small typically articulated with an E. Something full is typically with a P or a B. And when we begin to analyze sacred poetics, we're going to realize that this is indeed used to encode meaning. But if this were the true origin of all language, we should find far more instances of its occurrence than we do. And therefore, it is possible that speakers of a language could consciously choose certain places of articulation to encode certain ideas and concepts. Why is negation mapped to the nasal cavity, where the sound N is produced? Is that a coincidence, or was it chosen? We'll explore those kind of questions later. And since most speakers of language merely just use language, and few ever create novel words in language, this might be more pertinent to those who create words or create names. This subject is in reality endless, and having collected a vast quantity of material from numerous languages, I may say with a good conscience that any attempt to derive from such vague and constantly varying sounds the words of any language is utterly hopeless. The dog also says not only wo wo or bow bow, but also hoo hoo and cliff claff. When very angry and growling, he says rrr, which the Romans therefore called the dog letter, the littera canina. That some kind of communication is possible by means of such imitations of sound coupled with interjections or emotional expressions. In order to convey the information that a certain dog is harmless, we might say bow wow, poo. But communication is not language, as little as cries are roots. No tribe, however low, has yet been met with employing no more than such utterances, though on the other hand, no nation, however advanced in culture, dispenses entirely with such aids of communication. And it is but natural that more especially those who think that they can study in the child the mental states of the primitive savage should imagine that this parler enfantin explains the origin of all language. Why Müller would have such an opinion makes far more sense when we understand his theory of language, that language was the faculty naming the act and the result the name or logos, and therefore looking for language in an underdeveloped mind as an infant's is a futile pursuit. Speaking of speakers who create names, I'll end this lecture with an example of how poetics employs onomatopoeia to unite the connotations and denotations of words. Müller writes, "We are ever told by scholars who ought to know better that the wisest of the Greeks took the same view and looked upon their imitative words as the roots of all human speech. No doubt the Greeks called this process onomatopoeia, of the making of words, but they did this in order to distinguish the process of manufacturing artificial words from the original creation of words, which they tried to explain in a very different way, namely either physai or thesai, by nature or by law. I go even a step further, and I have tried on several occasions to show that as from a proper name, such as Socrates, we can form a kind of appellative, a Socrates in the sense of a wise man. So some of these interjections and imitation sounds too may well have been raised from time to time into the sphere of conceptual thought and language. But all this ought not to blind us or lead us to imagine that this conceptual process can account for the origin and growth of real language." Speaking of onomatopoeia, take for instance the word susurrant, which means whispering. The idea is, the sounds of whispers create a susurrant sound, and therefore the word susurrant imitates the whispers that it's denoting. The word susurrant comes from the Proto-Indo-European svar, in which we find in the Sanskrit svara, meaning noise, voice, vowel, or note, as in a musical note. It can mean to resound, ringing, whistling, to buzz, or to hum. But it can also mean to ache, to fester, to wound, or to injure. And an instance of the susurrant is in the word Sisyphus. Now Joseph Sansonides, in his book The Body of Myth, argues that the name Sisyphus is an onomatopoetic rendering of the susurrant sound Sisyphus, which the moving of breath makes in the nostrils. So if you were to close your mouth and breathe through your nose, you should hear the words. The breath, of course, being an important object of meditative concentration. Now, this repetitive inhalation and exhalation are described esoterically in the myth as the up-down motion of Sisyphus and his boulder on a hill. Now, the myth of Sisyphus is that Hades makes Sisyphus roll a huge boulder up and down a steep hill as punishment for his trying to trick the gods. The maddening nature of the punishment was reserved for Sisyphus, due to his hubristic belief that his cleverness surpassed that of Zeus himself, the leader of the gods. Here is our first example of how very abstract concepts like meditation and breath control are encoded in words like Sisyphus, which are then employed in myth, that if at any point in the understanding of Sisyphus one attempts to separate the myth from the meditative practice, it will lose its sense-making power, as is often found in the voices of those who interpret myth without a rigorous study of grammar and etymology. For who isn't seeking to obey the breath in their wanderings? That is to say, if the vagus nerve or the wandering nerve is playing a role in breath control, meditative concentration, and self-discipline, then there is great mnemonic value in us learning the underlying imagery of verb roots before we start naming functional regions of the brain. And could it be that imagery is a guide for discovering new connections and associations prior to observing a manifested form? We shall inspire before we expire, like Sisyphus. In the next lecture, we'll take upon the physi-thesi debate in depth.